Good morning and welcome to St. Francis in the Foothills to the second Sunday of Easter. It is good to have you here. I have a couple of announcements. One is a sad announcement. Reed Gilbert went in for gallbladder surgery. Please keep him and Barbara in your prayers. The other are really good announcements. Josh came out with an album this week. You should go to his webpage and find that and buy that and support him. I also have some other people that you want to support, Lisa and Diane. Are giving concerts every Tuesday and Thursday, and you will want to be there for those. They are marvelous. And Cynthia is doing a concert almost every day. And so look on their websites and find out where that's at so that you can be part of that. Welcome to St. Francis. Let's enjoy the celebration together.
This is God's wondrous world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is God's wondrous world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, God's hands the wondrous wrought. This is God's wondrous world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the moonlit night, let all creation praise. This is God's wondrous world. Love shines in all that's fair, in the rustling grass or the mountain pass, love's voice speaks everywhere. This is God's wondrous world. Oh, let me never forget that though the wrong seems oh so strong, love is the ruler yet. This is God's wondrous world. Why should my heart be sad? Let voices sing, let the heavens ring. Love reigns, let earth be glad.
Our call to awareness this morning is named The Challenge of a Blessing by Jan Richardson. Part of the challenge involved with a blessing is that receiving it actually places us for a time in the position of doing no work, of simply allowing it to come. For those who are accustomed to constantly doing and giving and serving, being asked to stop and receive can cause great discomfort. To receive a blessing, we have to give up some of our control. We cannot direct how the blessing will come, and we cannot define where the blessing will take us. We have to let it do its own work in us, beyond our ability to chart its course.
I will bring a cup of water. Here's the best that I can offer. In the dusk of coming night, there is evidence of light. With the pattering of rain, let us bow as if in grace. Consider all the ways we heal and how a heart can break. Abide with me where it it's breathless and it's empty. Yes, abide with me, and we'll pass the evening gently. Stay awake with me, and we'll listen more intently to some wordless and remaining, sure and ever changing in the quietness of now. Let us ponder the unknown, what is hidden, what is home, and finally learn to travel at the speed of our own souls. There is a living water, a spirit cutting through, always changing, always making all things new. Abide with me, where it's breathless and it's empty. Yes, abide with me, and we'll pass this evening gently. Stay awake with me, and we'll listen more intently to some wordless and remaining, sure and ever changing in the quietness of now. There are things I cannot prove, and still somehow I know it's like a message in a bottle an unseen hand has thrown. You don't have to be afraid. You don't have to walk alone. I don't know, but I suspect that it will feel like home. Abide with me, where it's breathless and it's empty. Yes, abide with me, and we'll pass the evening gently. Stay awake with me, and we'll listen more intently to some wordless and remaining, sure and ever changing in the quietness of now.
Robin and Grandfather. School is closed, but why? Mom is a doctor and she tried to explain the problem with the virus. I guess it's like the flu, but we don't have a vaccine for it yet. And lots of people around the world are dying. That's just terrible. But so is not going to school and seeing my friends. Mom says we have to stay in the house for a while until a vaccine is created. But I'm mad and sad. I want to play with my friends. How long will this last? I've got a lot of questions I want answered, like now.
This will come to an end. You'll be able to get back to school. You have to be patient like all of us. I know it's hard. I'll tell you what, look at the flowers. Remember back in winter when they were hardly buds? Remember how we trusted they would bloom in the spring? Well, that's what you have to do now. Trust the flowers will bloom. We'll trust that a vaccine will be created. Take a deep breath. Let it out real slow. Doesn't that help you feel better? If you Zoom with your friends and see what they're doing today, wouldn't that help you feel better? Watch old movies with your parents, bake some cookies, paint a picture, read a good book. Make a card and send it to a friend. Say a prayer asking the Creator for the healing of the world and the patience to watch it happen. Do those ideas help? Before you know it, this will be history. You will have lived to tell the story to your grandkids. And when they have a hard time come up in their lives, you'll be able to tell them about the 2020 virus, about when you had to stay in the house and didn't know when you could return to school. That's a better story than the one I tell you about walking to school in the snow. We're becoming stronger and more patient with each day. We're becoming kinder to others around us.
Okay, Grandfather. I'll try to be patient. I'll try to be kind. Thank you for loving me.
We are building a new way. We are building a new way. We are building a new way, feeling stronger every day. We are building a new way. We are working to be free. We are working to be free. Peace and freedom is our cry. Peace and freedom is our cry. Peace and freedom is our cry. Without these, the world will die. Peace and freedom is our cry.
Hello, this is Pastor Jim, and Nubis and I were going for a run down on the Tonkeverde Wash this morning, but I got a message from the Green Team, and they're re-upping themselves and coming back online, especially this year in the 50th anniversary of Earth Day. And so they wanted to have some time to be able to talk with you, and they sent me a message that I think you'd love to hear. Here it goes. A striking image in the news of these past 4 weeks was a side-by-side photo of New Delhi. Before the quarantine, the air was dense with gray smog. Then after clear blue skies. On this 50th anniversary of Earth Day, or as people of faith may call it, the celebration of God's creation, that photo made me wonder, what if we acted on life lessons learned from this pandemic? What if we learned the actions of an individual multiplied by millions can change the fate of all of us? What if we really learned that every life is precious and each of us can act to protect the lives of all of us? What if we learned from this month that worldwide disasters like pandemics and climate chaos hurt the poor and powerless first and worst, and took on our God-given responsibility to do something about that? What if we learned to take seriously the warnings of scientists and act in time to change the path we are on? That failing to act on these warnings is far more expensive in the long run than acting promptly, and that our grandmothers got it right, a stitch in time saves nine. What if we learned that shopping isn't entertainment, focused on money, on the necessities, with the excess honoring Matthew 24, I was hungry and you fed me. What if we learned the invisible things, like viruses and carbon molecules multiplying out of our control, are the real dangers? Weapons of war can't protect us from these, but an empowered humanity can. What if the iconic photo from this time isn't of a magnified coronavirus, but of New Delhi, the air healed in a matter of days? What if? What if? Let's care for our earth during this time and answer some of those questions, both inside our spirits and in our world. God bless.
We would like to thank our choir director, Cynthia Hiltz, for laying down the piano track for this tune.
Morning. Now is our time for prayer. You might want to dance your prayer. You might want to draw your prayer. You might want to sit in a lovely space where you can relax. I'm here in my rose garden. So let's just take a minute and prepare and breathe in and out together. Deep breaths. Dear God, we pray this morning for health and healing. We pray for energy and wellness, good health and joy. We pray for all those struggling with the coronavirus. We pray for care and healing. We pray for those particularly vulnerable and those needing safety and protection. We pray for all those with fear or anxiety, and we pray for peace of mind and spirit. Dear God, we pray for our brothers and sisters around the world. We pray for shared solidarity. We pray for public officials and decision makers. We pray that there be wisdom and guidance. We pray for our church, St. Francis in the Foothills, our members, our visitors, its leaders. We pray for each one of you this morning, and especially those struggling. Take a moment to bring forth anyone that's on your heart. We continue to pray that our community grant us peace, grant us comfort, grant us healing as we celebrate together today. And we give thanks for the ways that we're able to still keep in touch through telephone, letter, computer, and love. Be with us, O Lord, as we bless one another, our community, and our world. And we say, Amen. Thank you. Have a blessed day.
Good morning, I'm Raleigh Loomis. I'm so glad that you joined us here at St. Francis for worship this morning. Our scripture is from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 7. Blessed be God, who by great mercy has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. In this you rejoice, even if for now, for a little while, you've had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Christ is revealed.
So Peter tells us something that I don't really like at all. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith is tested by fire. Now, I don't believe God tests our faith. But life certainly does and teaches us through that. I just don't really ever like it. Maybe you do, but it's a challenge. But it does teach us. 30 years ago or so was the first time that I appeared in the Arizona Republic, the newspaper up in Phoenix. Not me specifically or by name, but the Independent Campaign Committee with which I was working at the time. It was a campaign committee formed by the Arizona Education Association, and we endorsed Jane D. Hall for the Arizona House. Now, we don't typically endorse conservative Republicans, but in this case, we chose that as the best choice for us. But her reaction to it is that she didn't want, didn't need, had no desire for an endorsement by the Teachers Association. Moments like that in life are what taught me that I am both very capable in affecting life around me and the people there, and very influential in the world, and at the same time, not completely in control. Didn't matter how much it was good for whatever choice I was making, Jane D. Hall, who we mourn this week, did not want my endorsement. Life often tries to assert the not completely in control over us, tries to tell us that we're not in control, because people would love to take us out of our power, especially if it clashes with their ideas or their desires. This week I read a horrendous quote by a man named Don Huizinga. He's the head of the Liberate Minnesota movement that right now is gathering people to fight against being under the captivity of stay-at-home policies. And he wrote, "Some of us understand what is happening. The rest of the sheep do not. Wait for the violence. It will happen. People in our culture are not designed to obey these kinds of orders." Now, to be fair, I, as much as Don Huizinga, would like to be released from captivity. I chafe at, and maybe most of you are that way as well. We wish we had more control in the current situation. But sometimes, maybe even often, asserting our control is not the pathway of the Spirit. In our call to awareness, Jan Richardson said that part of the challenge involved with a blessing is receiving it actually places us in the position of doing no work, of simply allowing it to come. And I know that this moment doesn't feel like a blessing. Doesn't feel like something we would have invited or welcome into our lives. And I definitely don't believe in a deterministic world where God has everything pre-planned and under control, nor one in which God tests the genuineness of our faith. But I believe that in this moment, the power that is the divine, the power that I see in relationship, in love, can be wonderfully manifest through what is going on in the world around us. The song with which we started, that the trio did so wonderfully well. This is God's wondrous world, calls out blessings to us on a regular basis. In this week in which we celebrate Earth Day, that world, those mountains, the trees, the buds that are coming out, every new bud, every act of nature declares the blessings of God. Large and small, gloriously beautiful, but also some which we don't understand or like as well. Viruses hold a place in this world, and it's a place from which sometimes we benefit, even if this particular virus is not beneficial and we correctly fight against it and rightfully take steps to eradicate it. Virus itself sometimes benefits us. And the challenge of this lockdown, the challenge of what it brings to us, goes way beyond just that virus. What else can come? The current set of circumstances around us has drawn all of us outside our realm of control and our sphere of influence, at least in its entirety. And the song about God's wondrous world might be telling us to rest in the uncontrol. That doesn't mean that God's plan for us is perfect. Theology is the right way to go. But the opening ourselves up to a new spiritual practice in this moment, a practice of trying to figure out in this moment how to deal with what is beyond our control. Look at this meme. If someone wants your toilet rolls, give to them your hand gel also. That's sort of from Matthew 5, the Sermon on the Mount. As Jesus tried to say, we have to, in this moment of not liking what comes to us, figure out what next. Can we, in this moment, trust the expertise of medical voices that are beyond our expertise? Can we allow our supply chain to bring us necessities even while we would rather go there to where they are? Can we allow a chance for a flawed government, a very flawed government, to help bring order to this moment? All of those just might be the necessary spiritual practice to draw us toward a space of better understanding. This moment, Easter, this time of year, is not a singular day. It is a season. And there's time to take, to become, to discover something new. But we have to allow ourselves to take this time to grow into something that we've never been before. In this separation instead of celebration, in this space of needing each other while we cannot have each other, in this time when we are distant and our hearts and spirits call out to each other, can we discover something we've never been before? Both individually and as a congregation, can we become all of those things? Ray Bradbury said, "We are the miracle of force and matter making itself over into imagination and will. Incredible. The life force experimenting with forms, you for one, me for another. The universe has shouted itself alive. We are one of the shouts." There is something amazing about every single one of you. Now, I don't always act like that's true, because sometimes the amazing also grinds against something that I want, something that I'm trying to figure out. And you asserting yourself sometimes doesn't make sense to me, but it doesn't make you any less amazing. In fact, it may be in that very moment that I can discover that which calls me forward. And it can remind me and help me rediscover the wonder not only of who I have been created to be, but who you have been created to be. Or as Peter puts it, "Blessed be God who by great mercy has given us new birth into an inheritance that's imperishable, undefiled, and unfading." See, we are born into an inheritance that even when everything goes wrong, continually draws us towards the best, the highest, the grandest, because that is what is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. That is what is true about each one of us. Rumi said it this way: "You have seen your own strength, you have seen your own beauty, you have seen your golden wings. Of anything else, why do you worry? You are in truth the soul of the soul of the soul." So in this moment, if we have our own way of doing things, we might choose differently than what it is thrusting upon us. In this moment, can we become that which we should truly be? The United Church of Christ has a poster that they put out. It says this: "Be the church. Protect the environment," like what our green team told us to do. "Care for the poor. Forgive often. Reject racism. Fight for the powerless. Share earthly and spiritual resources. Embrace diversity. Love God. Enjoy this life. Be the church in this moment. The coronavirus took one of the prophets of my life, John Prine, this week. And he wrote in his song called Hello in There. He said, so if you're walking down the street sometime and spot some hollow ancient eyes, please don't just pass them by and stare as if you didn't care. Say hello in there. Hello. World around you, however divided that world may be, however small it may seem in isolation, there are people who need you to say hello, who need you to care, who need you to reach out in love in some way or another. Phone calls, letters, just prayers that reach beyond just you. Find those ways, become those ways. Tom and Lorelei and Shannon sang the song Imagine. That song about looking past ourselves, looking into what doesn't necessarily make sense right now. But to achieve John Lennon's dream, we have to move into the uncomfortable, into the chaos, into what we don't understand, because there is where we will discover the unimaginable. Amen.
The spirit in me brings sin in you, hallelujah. God's in us and living God, hallelujah.
The spirit in me brings sin in you, hallelujah. God's in us and living God, hallelujah. Spirit in me brings sin in you, hallelujah. God's in us and we're in God, hallelujah.
And so go into your world and be the gift that the world needs. Go into the spaces of need, whatever they happen to be, however small they seem, and bring God there so that all of us are enriched. Amen.
Awake from your slumber, arise from your sleep. A new day is dawning for all those who weep. The people in darkness have seen a great light. The Lord of our longing has conquered the light. City of God, may our tears be turned into dancing, for the Lord, our light of our love, has turned the night into day. We are sons of the morning, we are daughters of day. The one who has loved us has brightened our way. The Lord of all kindness has called us to be a light for all people to set their hearts free. Let us build a city of God. May our tears be turned into dancing, for the Lord, our light and our love, has turned. Let us build a city of God. May our tears be turned into dancing, for the Lord.